I'm just showing you the Bill 50 lines right now. The Bill 50 lines also are two AC lines going all the way up to Fort McMurray. Oh, by the way, they're critical, but we don't need to build them to 2020. As ASO told me at a presentation one day, just because we say they're critical doesn't mean we need them right away. That's a quote. This is amazing. Down in southern Alberta, we're building what's called the 240 closed loop system. It's called the Southern Reinforcement. It's under construction right now, I believe. And the reason I show that is it's part of the $16.6 billion I'm going to talk about. But with the two HVDC lines, people down there think that they're going to hook up to this 240 kV system. And it's like, not. That's the stovetop I'm talking about. You cannot put all that power into that 240 system. It's too small. That's not what they're being used for. But this is my favorite part of Bill 50. I've never seen anything like it, and I hope I never see anything like it again. It's about $100, $150 million substation. It's in the law. They approved it. Nobody knows what's connecting into it, and nobody knows what's connecting out of it. Now, I know ASO has a plan, but the people who approved it, the MLAs that voted on it, they voted to spend $100, $150 million, and they don't have a clue. They don't even know where it's going. They just know it's going somewhere southeast of Calgary. I've never seen anything approved like that. I was an engineer. To get any kind of approval on any kind of project, the first thing you needed was an economic study showing why you would need something. Then you need detailed plans on how it would work within the system. And then you'd go for approval with your own boss before you'd ever get to a board hearing. We got a substation. I can't tell you what's going into it. I can't tell you what's coming out of it. It's just been approved. Blanket. No cost-benefit analysis on any of these lines whatsoever. None. Never been done. Now we're going to just step outside of Bill 50 because all those Bill 50 lines don't do a thing. They don't do a thing for Alberta. Matter of fact, they say that Calgary needs the power. That HVDC line on the west side of the province does not even connect to Calgary. Doesn't push one more watt of power into Calgary. It bypasses Calgary. It's staggering because any electrician could read those wiring schematics and say, wait a minute, you're not pushing any more power into Calgary. So what's outside of these Bill 50 lines don't do anything for us yet until we get just outside of Bill 50, which are the twin 500 kV lines going up to Grand Prairie and then over to BC. We call that export. Down in the southern part of the province, you know when I was talking about Brooks? These are right out of ASO's 10-year plans. This is where I get this documentation from. It's right in their 10-year plan. They got an HVDC line going to Saskatchewan, then down to the U.S., and an HVDC line going due south, right to Montana. Take a look at Fort McMurray. Got a HVDC line heading north, and then they have an AC line heading into Saskatchewan. Now look at all those black diamonds up in Fort McMurray. Look at all that electricity. Those are massive generators, every one of them. TransCanada proposed building an HVDC line from Fort McMurray to the Pacific Northwest. It was called the Northern Lights Project. They're not going to build it. You know why they're not going to build it? It's not economic. It's not economic. An HVDC line is only economic if it's 500 kilometers or more. We know that. TransCanada was proposing to build what they call a market line, a private line, from Fort McMurray all the way to almost Portland, Oregon. And they could not make it work. And it was a lot more than 500 kilometers. And it was not economic. So what are we doing as taxpayers? We're building two HVDC lines in the province. One's 330 kilometers long, and the other's a little over 400. Neither one even gets to the break-even point where it could even be economical, and we're building two of them. It's absolutely outrageous. So we get into this idea, we need all these transmission lines because of growth. But I want to talk about this growth because it's such a misrepresented fact in this province, and it is a fact. We want to grow, we are going to grow. But one thing our government and the ASO leave out, we're called an energy province, and every citizen in this province knows this. And every time we grow economically, something happens. We produce more electricity than we consume. You don't know this, but you're drowning in excess electricity. I'm about to prove that to you. And this is right off AltaLink's website, looking at generation growth versus demand. Every time an in-situ mining operation starts, every time an upgrader is built, every time a refinery is built, they produce more electricity than they use. So we grow more generation, we produce more electricity than our demand actually grows. And that's important to know. So we get into this whole distortion of what's happening out here. And our government has continually tried different tactics. So Ed Stelmach wrote a letter to his constituents and said, we haven't built any major upgrades in 20 years. It's a big one. You'll still hear it on the radio. They still put it out in their documentation. And the AESO jumps on, they say, we haven't built anything in 2 decades. And don't worry about this. This is the guy in charge of our finances. He thinks 2 decades is 40 years. But the AESO, if they haven't done anything in 20 years, the whole lot of them should be fired, the entire organization. But that's not true. They even produced a report to their stakeholders. Basically, 9 major projects that were completed in 2010. Oh, by the way, they called it major transmission upgrades. And they built them, and they should have. But this idea that the government or AESO is going out and saying, we haven't done anything major in 20 years, is not true. Because this report from the AESO to the stakeholders says, oh yeah, by the way, here's all the major projects we finished. Oh, by the way, they're still doing major projects. We always upgrade the system. We should upgrade the system. This so-called premise that we haven't done anything is ridiculous. And even if we haven't done anything in 20 years, if you ask the AESO, how long do transmission lines last? They say 70 years. You go to the Western Electric Coordinating Council, and I'm going to talk about these guys. The Western Electric Coordinating Council, the WECC, is basically the authority setting rules and protocols for 22 Western states, Alberta and BC, and some northern Mexican provinces. They train our own AESO engineers, the Alberta Electric System Operator, our own AESO engineers, will go to AESO training to learn how to plan the system. They say those lines can last 90 years, and they'll even admit they can last 100 years. So why is our government out there saying we haven't done anything in 20 years, so we need to spend billions of dollars? Because it's all propaganda. And I really want to put this in context. The lower 48 embarked upon a major, major upgrade to the electricity system down in the U.S. $10 billion. For a $10 trillion economy, 350 million people, and Alberta is going to engage in a $16.6 billion investment for 3.5 million people. The comparison is staggering. So they go out there and they tell people, if we don't build this, by 2009 the lights are going to go out, and this is what they were doing in 2006. Our own Alberta Electric System Operator was saying in 2006, if we don't build that transmission line between Edmonton and Calgary, the lights are going out. And I mean, seriously, they were saying the lights were going out. They had headlines in the Calgary newspaper saying we're going to have blackouts by 2009. They forgot to tell them nothing connected to Calgary, but that's beside the point. It's embarrassing that they wrote this, and they're all in this article. And Alberta Energy was out there telling the board and telling the public. They were writing letters and saying that we testified for this line. I always like to point this one out. The board was hearing a case on whether or not we should build a transmission line. The Department of Energy was their boss, and they came and testified for the transmission line. How do you think the board's going to decide? But they were telling people these are risks of outages. And AltaLink was out there saying we're going to have rolling blackouts. And they were doing this as late as 2008 when EPCOR, and I actually went to a luncheon when one of the vice presidents of EPCOR was spouting this stuff off. They said the lights were going to go out. The system was never, ever, ever as close to breaking as it is today. But the reality, they can tell the press one thing. If you look at what was given under oath at the original hearing in 2004, they said there was plenty of megawatts down south. There's no risk of outages. That was in 2004. In 2009, when we set a record all-time high, what they did is the AESO came forward and said there's more than enough power to meet demand. It was just a little over 10,000 megawatts. Now, you may remember, just barely a couple of months ago, this year, we actually went a couple of years without setting a record demand. We set a new record demand finally, and we should have. We hit 10,600 megawatts. And what happened when we hit that? We lost 2 generators. So we hit a record demand, and we lost 2 generators at the same time. What did the AESO say? We got more than enough power to meet the supply. What's going on? Because they're out in the public now saying we need more electricity. Yet when they actually are on the record, That's not what they're saying. So that wasn't working for them in my argument. So this one I like to call lying losses. It's all about line loss. And it's one I take a personal offense to. And I know this for a fact, because I know some of the engineers, both in the private sector and in the ASO and in the board. To give line loss in monetary terms is not just disingenuous. It's really deceitful. So our ASO and our government saying we're losing enough power that it's $3 million a month. That's $36 million a year. And they like this one. That's enough power to power the city of Red Deer. So, ooh, that's a lot of power. And without building anything, without doing anything, holy cow, Ed Stelmach said in the newspaper, now we're losing not $36 million a year, we're losing $250 million a year. This is crazy. This is going downhill fast. And without doing anything, all of a sudden now we're only losing $70 million a year. Wow. I don't know who did what, but we should give them a bonus for that one. And then all of a sudden, what happened? The system broke again. Now we're losing $350 million a year. I'll tell you what's happening. They're making it up. They're making it up. The dirty buggers are just making it up, and they're just scaring people for no good reason. And they're called MLAs. Because you measure a system not by monetary terms, you measure it in a percentage of loss. Now, the way I tell a lot of farmers this is real simple. When they leave this building, they get in their pickup truck, they start that motor, they lose power from the motor to the wheels. There's power loss. NASCAR engineers specialize in getting the most power from the engine to the wheels. That's what they do. When you transmit electricity, the longer the extension cord, the more power you lose. The longer the transmission line, it's a matter of physics, the more power you lose. Oh, by the way, you add a generator to the system, the more power you lose. They don't tell you that. You measure an electricity system by the percentage of power lost, and a typical system loses between 5 and 7%. That's the standard. So how's Alberta really doing? Well, I did some checking. In 2007, we lost 4%. That's pretty good. This is the overall system. Whoa, 3.8% in 2008. That didn't go up, it went down. Remember, this is the same time period. It's like we're at the risk of the system breaking, power out, rolling blackouts. In 2009, the line loss is going down. Holy cow. That was the year they stopped printing that stuff in line loss. Now you got to get it in monetary terms. This is a chart you'll never find on the ASO website. I say they took it off because it's on the screen. They deny it. But I got it right from the ASO. It's the line loss on a chart going all the way back down to 2003. And the two times it hit 6% loss, it was 40 below zero. I checked the dates. Since 2003, we've never even come close to 7%. What's it tell you? It tells you the system's working pretty good. It's not close to breaking. Now, this is something I found out in my research. Before deregulation, I call it BD, before deregulation, Alberta had one of the best electricity systems in all of North America, and we had some among the cheapest electricity bills. And not only did we have one of the best systems, we ranked generally between 1 and 3 at all times as being one of the best. That's significant, because even when you rate systems today, they bounce up and down. Alberta had a fantastic system by anybody's standards. We deregulated, and now you got the bills you have. And you got a government and an ASO who says they're independent, claiming the system's breaking, but the data doesn't support it. The data does not support it. What is going on? I'm here to tell you what's going on is people can no longer tell the truth to the public. That's what's going on. And we got to get to the bottom of this.